Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Concentration Camps, A Very Short Introduction, by Dan Stone. Narrated by Paul Woodson. Preface. A book such as this must aim not to be comprehensive, but to ask relevant questions. This book ranges widely, drawing on a voluminous scholarly literature, and I hope that listeners will find some clearly defended opinions and some suggestions for thinking about the topic in greater detail. But most of all, I hope that they will not expect all the answers. If the questions I raise are thought-provoking, then the book has done its job. There are many other paths to follow than those taken here, and I hope the book will encourage listeners to go down some of them. This is an unpleasant topic, but one that can hardly be sidestepped if one is interested in the nature of the modern world. I have not spent too much time on highfalutin theories of what it all means, though I linger with some of these ideas in the final chapter, because I wanted to explore the ways in which different sorts of concentration camps have emerged in different political, social, geographical, and chronological contexts over the last century or so. Only by knowing something of the history of concentration camps can one begin to consider their meaning for our civilization. The book is therefore arranged more or less chronologically, only turning at the end to address theories of what concentration camps tell us about the modern world. Chapter 1. What is a concentration camp? In his summing up at the trial of Oswald Pohl et al., one of the so-called subsequent trials at Nuremberg, Judge Michael Musmano noted that, in the general lurid picture of World War II, with its wrecked cities, uprooted farmland, demolished transportation facilities, and public utilities, starvation, disease, ashes, death, rubble, and dust, one item of horror seems to stand out with particularly dramatic and tragic intensity. The concentration camp. It can be seriously doubted in the world of today, even among the most meagerly informed peoples, that there exists a man or woman who, in some manner or other, has not heard of and recoiled at the mention of the phrase concentration camp. If this were true in 1946, how more true it must be today. The Holocaust has become in much of the world the ultimate signifier of evil. At its heart lay the Nazi concentration and death camps. Since then, the world has not only learned more about the Nazi camps, but has discovered that concentration camps originated several decades before the Third Reich began using them, and has witnessed their use again in numerous locations. From wars of decolonization in Africa to the Yugoslav wars of the 1990s, no wonder that Zygmunt Bauman calls the 20th century the century of camps. They have become defining symbols of humankind's lowest point and basest acts. Indeed, for some thinkers, concentration camps are nothing less than the key to understanding modernity, the nomos of the modern, as philosopher Giorgio Agamben puts it. This short book will address these grand claims, but it will begin on a more prosaic basis, because before we can pronounce on the significance of concentration camps for the modern world, we need to be clear about what they are and how they have developed. We need a history of the concentration camp in order to consider why this institution is so important to modern consciousness and identity. First, the book will trace the concentration camp's origins in 19th century colonial settings, such as Australia and the United States, in Cuba, South Africa, and German Southwest Africa, today Namibia, in the last years of the 19th and first years of the 20th centuries, and in the genocide of the Armenians during the last days of the Ottoman Empire. It will go on to examine the Nazi camp system, comparing labor camps devised to build the racial community with concentration camps set up to exclude and eventually to eradicate unwanted others. It will show that the images and testimonies of the liberation of the Nazi camps have shaped our definition of concentration camps. It will then go on to examine the Stalinist system of camps and special settlements known as the Gulag, and compare the totalitarian country's use of camps with those of other, less well-known settings, such as the American internment of Japanese-American citizens during the Second World War, Franco's camps during and after the Spanish Civil War, Britain's use of camps for Jewish displaced persons, DPs, in Cyprus trying to reach Palestine after the Second World War, the colonial powers' resort to camps during the wars of decolonization, such as in Algeria, Malaya, and Kenya, the Chinese use of camps during the Maoist period, the Khmer Rouge's attempt to turn the whole of Cambodia into a giant concentration camp in the 1970s, the reappearance of concentration camps during the genocide in Bosnia in the 1990s, and the contemporary camp system in North Korea. I will show that this widespread use of concentration camps is not a coincidence. It tells us something about the modern state and about the ways in which such practices were learned, borrowed, and spread from one place to another. Lastly, the book will examine the meaning and significance of the concentration camp. Are concentration camps states of exception divorced from society and the rule of law? And if so, do they therefore function as windows onto the deeper desires of modern states' leaders, or are they aberrant sites? Can a meaningful comparison be made between concentration camps such as the Nazis and refugee camps or detention centers? What about contemporary settings such as favelas, shantytowns, and sweatshops in the global South? That such questions can be posed suggests that sociologists and philosophers who have asked them are not troubled only by the historical existence of concentration camps, but by the possibility that for large sections of today's population, the world is effectively a giant concentration camp. There is clearly a need to obtain clarity over the concentration camp's history so that distinctions can be drawn between meaningful insight and political polemic. I will suggest that although concentration camps exist on a continuum of carceral practices that includes prisons, detention centers, and extraterritorial holding pens such as Guantanamo Bay, and although there is no easy or one-size-fits-all definition to be found, yet there is something that distinguishes concentration camps from other sorts of camps where civilians are temporarily held against their will, such as DP camps, internally displaced persons, IDP camps, or refugee camps. This book will offer an up-to-date history of concentration camps in a global setting and engage with the philosophical literature dealing with the complex question of what the camps tell us about the nature of the modern world. What is a concentration camp? A working definition is that it is an isolated, circumscribed site with fixed structures designed to incarcerate civilians. A concentration camp is not normally a death camp, although death camps in the context of the Holocaust obviously derived from concentration camps and the killing of asylum patients, the so-called euthanasia program, in terms of their institutional history. No one was concentrated in the Nazi death camps of Chełmno, which was actually not really a camp in any meaningful sense, Sobibor, Bełżec, or Treblinka, where Jews and a small number of Roma and Sinti were sent to die. The so-called work Jews held as functionaries at these camps, as carpenters, blacksmiths, and so on, to facilitate their running were few in number and also destined to die. The Holocaust has confused our understanding of concentration camps, in that the SS's camp system, as well as the many other camps in Nazi-occupied Europe run by other agencies, such as the Wehrmacht, industry, or local councils, was separate from the program known as the Final Solution to the Jewish Problem, until quite late in the war. And because two camps, Majdanek and Auschwitz, combined the functions of concentration camp and death camp. As we will hear, the Nazi concentration camps in the strict sense were not established to murder the Jews. Their history of change, and during the war, massive expansion, was primarily in response to the Nazis' wish to eradicate political and asocial enemies in the first place, and to provide slave labor for the Reich later on in the context of total war. The confusion arose primarily because Holocaust survivors were found at the concentration camps liberated by the Allies in spring 1945, after having been forcibly marched westwards from camps evacuated in the face of the Soviet advance. Following the defeat of Nazi Germany, the world thought it knew what a concentration camp was. Take, for example, journalist Patrick Gordon Walker's description in his 1945 book The Lid Lifts, which described concentration camps as one of the exclusive characteristics and manifestations of our own age, one of the distinguishing marks by which you may know the 20th century. What is it exactly that distinguishes in our minds a concentration camp from other forms of confinement? Barbed wire, herded and crowded masses of humanity, the open-air armed guards mounted on raised towers, these are the outward aspects of the concentration camp. They are the consequences of large numbers of opponents. That is, I think, the essential peculiarity of the concentration camp. The very large number of those whom you wish to deprive of liberty, far too many for the discipline, order, and expense of prisons. When the concentration camp becomes a permanency, it is the sign of a regime that knows it cannot command national support or even tolerance. It accepts the fact that very large numbers of its citizens, far beyond the normal percentage of criminals, are in irreconcilable opposition, or at any rate, that these very large numbers of people must be deprived of their liberty. Together with this goes the inescapable corollary of a lowered respect for humanity. Men and women are herded there who have been deprived of the elemental legal rights that clothe the human being who is still regarded as such, naked men and women. Although accurate in many ways, Gordon Walker missed some essential points here. These very large numbers of people are irreconcilable opponents insofar as the regime in power perceives them to be. They are not necessarily people who have committed a crime. Indeed, they are highly unlikely to be criminals in any proper legal sense. Although there are usually real criminals in concentration camps, to give some appearance of truth to the regime's claims, and, in the case of Nazi Germany at least, to aid the regime's goal of social cleansing. They are enemies only because the regime has defined them as such, due to some characteristic: appearance, race, class, political identification, religion, that the regime perceives as intolerable or threatening. They're also, most important, usually civilians. One should note that sometimes prisoners of war, POWs, or resistance fighters have also been held in concentration camps. These civilians are not armed opponents of a regime, rebels, terrorists, or insurrectionists, who have been incarcerated and are treated according to the laws of warfare. Quite to the contrary. And here is the crucial point that Gordon Walker hints at but does not explicitly set out. The inmates of concentration camps, I will try to avoid the word prisoners because this connotes legal incarceration following a trial for a criminal activity, are outside the law. The nakedness to which Gordon Walker refers is their existential condition. As Agamben describes them, they are reduced to bare life and held in a state of exception, where the law holds no sway, and where they can be treated as the guards or the higher authorities choose, with no possibility of redress. They are effectively the dead on leave. These are issues to which this book will return. Finally, we should note that Gordon Walker's description of the physical characteristics of a concentration camp is a description of a Nazi concentration camp. The iconic image that comes to mind is of Dachau, or Buchenwald, the sealed camp, guarded by barbed wire and watchtowers, with the entrance gate with its ironic inscription, Jedem das Seine, to each his own, or Arbeit macht frei, work sets you free. But as this book will explore, a concentration camp need not look like a Nazi camp in order to qualify as such. In the far north or far east of the Soviet Union, for example, there was no need for barbed wire fences. If an inmate escaped, there was nowhere to go. Importantly, Gordon Walker went on to note that the Third Reich was not the first regime to use concentration camps, but he argued that the German ones were basically and brutally different from their predecessors in the Boer War, China, Spain, France, Russia, India, or Britain, where internment camps had held German civilians, many of them Jewish enemy aliens, in 1940. The difference, according to Gordon Walker, consisted first in their scale, millions were interned in Germany, and second in their purpose, which mutated during the war from destroying political opponents to the deliberate aims of extermination and dehumanization, through which the standards of the West were to be assaulted and undermined. Gordon Walker was wrong about the numbers. As we will hear, far more people were incarcerated in Soviet and Chinese camps than in Nazi ones. We might also object that the standards of the West had already included using concentration camps in colonial settings, and certainly included a disregard for colonial subjects' lives. But on the second point, he produced an insight that goes to the heart of the problem. Describing the assault on Western civilization as sadism under calculating control, Gordon Walker highlighted the essential characteristic and terrifying problem of concentration camps, their rationality on the one hand, and their extreme, transgressive, and savage unreality on the other. Kevin Passmore's Fascism, a very short introduction, describes fascists as people who demanded order in the name of revolution, and revolution in the name of order. No wonder that the concentration camp is so firmly identified with fascism, for it might be regarded as brutality in the name of order, and order in the name of brutality. But only if we bear in mind that brutality here does not mean mere violence. Rather, it refers to a total abandonment of law and the creation of zones of exception where all manner of transgressive behavior was permitted, a secure space away from the norms of society where the ruling passion was license. Terror, in fact, becomes law. It is not arbitrary but imposed, as political philosopher Hannah Arendt wrote, in the name of destroying the fundamental features of humanity, eradicating spontaneity and making human beings superfluous. Arendt argued that what was so frightening about imperialism was that it created places where anything was permitted, where civilized law and mores did not apply. Concentration camps, especially in the colonial context, and here we might consider Arendt's idea that fascism was a variety of colonialism come home to Europe, were condensed versions of this license. They are places where de facto opponents of a regime, as defined by the regime, are held indefinitely, without recourse to law, stripped of all rights, and all subjected to total domination. Even though Arendt herself recognized that no regime is so perfect that it can actually establish total domination, one man will always be left to tell the story. The domination that concentration camps represent should leave us with no doubt as to the destructive capacities of the modern state. Arendt described three types of camps, corresponding to three basic Western conceptions of a life after death: Hades, Purgatory, and Hell. To Hades correspond those relatively mild forms, once popular in even non-totalitarian countries, for getting undesirable elements of all sorts, refugees, stateless persons, the asocial and the unemployed, out of the way, as DP camps, which are nothing other than camps for persons who have become superfluous and bothersome. They have survived the war. Purgatory is represented by the Soviet Union's labor camps, where neglect is combined with chaotic forced labor. Hell, in the most literal sense, was embodied by those types of camps perfected by the Nazis, in which the whole of life was thoroughly and systematically organized with a view to the greatest possible torment. All three types have one thing in common. The human masses, sealed off in them, are treated as if they no longer existed, as if what happened to them is no longer of any interest to anybody, as if they were already dead, and some evil spirit gone mad were amusing himself by stopping them for a while between life and death before admitting them to eternal peace. Arendt's distinctions between the Nazi and Soviet camps are unsustainable in certain respects. Nevertheless, the distinction between Hades, purgatory, and hell is helpful, as we will hear, even if the boundaries between them are not clear-cut. This book will show that Arendt's seemingly abstract observations in fact allow us to reconsider the history of concentration camps. Although she rightly places the Nazi camps at the apex of horror, we can use her classification to see that focusing only on the Nazi camps, or taking them as exemplary of concentration camps, is to miss important points in their history. Not least, if we accept that concentration camps need not look like Dachau or Belsen, we see that in some ways we have come full circle. The camps in the Democratic Republic of Congo that were established after the Rwandan genocide remind us of the camps of the Anglo-Boer War. Concentration camps are not only products of mad dictators, but have a global history that belongs to the liberal West as well. Most important, Arendt's basic point about concentration camps is worth holding on to. Concentration camps are experiments in the annihilation of man. That they have existed at all is a blot on humanity. That they still exist is an indictment of our fine pretensions to universal human rights. Chapter 2. Origins. Concentration camps existed a generation before the Third Reich proclaimed its existence, even though they might not have looked like Dachau. Where do the origins of the camps lie? Traditionally, the answer is South Africa, and one observes the same kind of peculiar British pride in being the originators of concentration camps as one sometimes encounters when discussing the occurrence of total genocide in the British settler colony of Tasmania. Yet historically speaking, it is too simple to say that the British simply invented concentration camps in the context of the Anglo-Boer War. First, there were precedents in Cuba and in the Philippines. But more to the point, the phenomenon of the concentration camp as it appeared in the late 19th and early 20th centuries was the logical extension of phenomena that had long characterized colonial rule. The use of reservations, of deporting population groups from their original places of residence to unsuitable locations away from the developing settler colonial territory, and of island prisons designed to hold unwanted remnants of indigenous peoples. Quarantine and lazarette islands, such as those in Mahon Harbor, leper colonies, workhouses, slavery plantations, and asylums might also be regarded as earlier precedents, if only insofar as they show that the principle of isolating groups perceived as dangerous has a long history. The Cuban and South African camps were certainly called concentration camps, but we need to bear in mind that the term has, since the end of the Second World War, called to mind something different from what it originally meant. That fact means that the early camps have been exploited by particular national myth-makers, who derive satisfaction from playing on the implied suggestion that concentration camps in South Africa, or Cuba, share similarities with those built by the Nazis. This means we need to analyze what the first concentration camps were for, how they developed, and most crucially, how they differ from those that came later. It is important, as Ian Smith and Andreas Stucki, two historians of concentration camps in colonial settings, remind us, to acknowledge distinctions when the same term is used to describe widely differing phenomena in different contexts and eras. That does not mean that there are no links to be found between camps in one place or time and another, merely that one cannot take such links for granted. Most important, the term concentration camp, like any other concept, means different things over time. Yet studying the early concentration camps can help us to understand how and why the camps emerged when they did, and clarify the links and differences between them and the concentration camps of the fascist and communist regimes of the mid-20th century. Prior to the existence of concentration camps, We can see that places of exclusion that colonial authorities set up often look, from today's perspective, like proto-concentration camps. That should not be surprising, since an institution such as a concentration camp bears similarities to many other sorts of institutions, such as military encampments, workhouses, reservations for natives, POW camps, and so on. Examples are easy to find. In the United States, the 1830 Indian Removal Act authorized the deportation of indigenous people from east of the Mississippi River to the as-yet non-incorporated territories of the North American continent. The so-called five civilized tribes, the Cherokee, Choctaw, Chickasaw, Seminole, and Creek nations, were deported on what became known as the Trail of Tears to a territory in present-day Oklahoma. The deportation itself was catastrophic for the Indians, thousands of whom died en route. But the worst would happen on arrival. Of the 10,000 Creeks who were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.